In this video lecture, we're going to give an introduction and short overview of methods, which are named reusable containers of instructions in Java, or any other programming language for that matter. Okay, let's get started. Okay, so for starters, what are methods? Methods are named software containers for some group of related statements, which taken together perform some specified action. A method says to some client software application, if you give me these inputs, I'll do the following for you. Methods are reusable, self-contained, or atomic elements of software. Here on the right, we see the generic black box model for any method. A method accepts zero or more input values, performs some actions or calculations upon those inputs, and returns zero or more output values to the user of that method. We use methods in programming to collect up some set of repeated instructions, which can then be executed in the aggregate using one single name. As an example of what methods are all about, I'm a busy middle-aged guy with a wife, two kids, a home, and this online class, among other things. So I've become a huge fan of to-do lists and checklists. With a checklist of some kind, one can carry out some detailed set of tasks, but refer to all those details under one blanket name, such as today's to-do list. Methods in Java let us do the same kind of thing with related software instructions. Methods in Java are also useful because they allow us to separate instructions, which are typically the same, from the input data they operate upon, which usually varies. Furthermore, methods also allow us to collect up and bury away the specific details from the user or some software client, so they can concentrate on the what and not the how. As we said in an earlier lecture, methods are one of the three main types of containers in object-oriented programming, or OOP. We said that variables were containers for data, so now methods are containers for instructions, or statements, in programs. We also said that classes in OOP were containers as well, and that they bundled together the related data and instructions for some real-world or abstract software things. Furthermore, we said that a class in OOP was the blueprint or template with which we could create new specific instances of that class, as shown in this diagram. Each of these objects is a new instance of this class, but each one with its own specific set of data. As it turns out, methods are actually much more central to a class than this figure might indicate. We'll see later on that actual classes tend to be a small handful of data together with a comparatively large number of methods which operate upon that data. We'll see this more clearly a bit later on when we start to use classes, or even later when we start to write our own classes. This idea of methods, or named groups of programming instructions, is by no means unique to Java. In fact, it's pretty universal across high-level programming or scripting languages. You might have already encountered methods under different names in other languages, such as functions, procedures, subroutines, macros, or scripts. All of these are similar or related terms for the same fundamental concept. So why do we want to use methods in software anyway? It really boils down to these three things: modularity, efficiency, and reusability. In terms of modularity, methods help us better structure and compartmentalize our code. They allow us to carve out or isolate repeated operations and to hide away the underlying details of our algorithms, or what we call encapsulation. By breaking up our programs into smaller chunks, it becomes easier to create and understand our software. Don't get buried by the details, focus on the bigger picture. In terms of efficiency, it's always preferable and much easier to write a large program by first breaking it up into lots of smaller, simpler pieces or methods. In fact, if we have to perform any set of operations more than a couple times, it's generally always a good idea to carve those steps out into their own method. Furthermore, it's always easier to find problems in or maintain smaller, more focused elements of software. As the often quoted saying goes, divide and conquer. Finally, in terms of reusability, it's just more efficient to carve out software tasks you need to do over and over again and put them into their own dedicated methods. By doing this, we make it easier to reuse the software on other projects. Better yet, it's easier to build larger software out of smaller, well-trusted pieces that have already been written. Write it once, than just reuse it. Well, it turns out that we've already seen and used methods in some recent programs we've written, though we might not have identified them as such. For starters, every program we've written so far has had a main method, and as we said earlier, every Java application requires there to be at least one such main method. In your first Hello World program, there was a dedicated print greeting method to print out a friendly greeting to you by name. And in your second Hello Again program, that method got moved into the supporting Hello class. Whenever we wanted to display some text to the screen, we've relied upon the system.out.println method, which is itself just a standard predefined system method. As we'll see soon, most Java classes contain one or more constructors, which are just special methods used to create new objects. All classes allow their objects to do certain things, and those actions are implemented by the methods of that class. Let's take a look at some of these recent method examples. Here's a first recent example of methods. This is the Hello World class that you wrote recently as your first lab assignment. Notice that it contains two methods, the required main method and the helper print greeting method. The main method is the client application of your program. When it wants to print out a greeting, it farms the workout to this print greeting method, and it supplies it the text for the first and last names it wants to have printed. The details are under the hood here in this print greeting method. If passed strings for the first name and last name, the print greeting method takes care of the details of incorporating that first and last name into some friendly greeting. Notice that this program is a little easier to follow and it's much more modular when we break it down into separate components like this. Here's another recent example of methods. This is the Hello class that you wrote recently as your second lab assignment. Remember, this was the helper class for the main application. Here we have four methods. Here's a constructor with the same name as the class. Here's the print greeting method. And here are the set first name and set last name methods. The constructor is a special method which initializes the data of a class. The print greeting is used the same way, except that now it's using the instance variables first name and last name internally to print the greeting. And the set first name and set last name are what we call mutators. Given some text for the first or last name, they're going to be used to set the values of these instance variables. And notice that this begins to resemble more of what an actual Java class would look like, a small amount of data and several methods which operate upon that data. To better understand the motivation for methods, take a look at the sample code on the left. This example computes and prints the area of five different circles, given the five different radii. It's very easy to write this code using some simple cut and paste, but it's also very inefficient because of all the repetitive operations. Here we're performing the same operations over and over, just with different data. Can we make this more efficient? Please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough for methodsinefficient.java. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the example source code module on Canvas. Come back to this video when you are finished. Here's a slightly improved version of the previous example. Notice that here we've encapsulated the area calculation into its own dedicated method, calculateArea. Also, notice that our declaration of pi has been removed from the main method and relocated into the method in which it's needed. While this is an improvement, notice that there is still code repetition that we could improve. Please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough for methodsmoreefficient.java. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the example source code module on Canvas. Come back to this video when you are finished. Finally, here's yet more improvement upon the previous example. Here, we not only have a dedicated method to calculate the area, we also have a new method to display that area. Notice how much leaner and simpler this has made the main client method. Also, notice how we are reusing the same variable for radius. We simply specify a radius value and provide it to the display circle method. That method in turn uses the existing method to calculate the area and then displays it internally. This example brings up a few points about methods. First, we should avoid the temptation to do too much in any one method. In other words, no kitchen sink methods. Keep them short and specific. As we've just seen here, We can always combine or nest our methods or create new ones if needed. Here, we've got one method calculating the area and another method displaying the area and radius, yet using the other one internally. Please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough for methods.stillmoreefficient.java. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the example source code module on Canvas. But this ends this introductory material on methods.